Hi, this is Dr. Georgia. I hope you find today's message a blessing in your life. We want to make sure that we continue to provide these video messages for you when you can't come to church, or for those of you who live in a different state, or we noticed recently we have a lot of people in even different countries who are tuning in. So if that is you and you can donate to us, we invite you to hit that donate button just below the message here. So thanks so much. Prepare ourselves. If you put your hand over your eyes, I open my eyes to see the spiritual truth today. And now over your ears, I open my ears to hear the spiritual truth today. And if you just cover your heart and extend out your arms, I open my heart to receive the spiritual truth today. The spiritual truth that I'm working with today is that peace is always in your heart. Peace is always in your heart. When you're having a screaming match with your spouse or your partner, peace is right where your heart is. When you have been accused of something that you know you didn't do and you're just filled with rage because you know you didn't do this thing, peace is in your heart. When you read one more Twitter that you think is your head is just going to explode, if you read one more Twitter, peace is in your heart. The problem is that we cover this peace up with fear in our heart. See, our work is to learn how to tap into that peace in the midst of fear. Jesus said in John chapter 14, verse 27, I'm leaving you a gift, and that gift is peace of mind. The great Buddhist teacher, Ajahn Brahm, said, fear is simply finding fault with the future. Fear is simply finding fault with the future. And Pema Chodron, who wrote the great book, When Life is Falling Apart, When Things Are Falling Apart, says this, an intimacy with fear in the stillness. In other words, get away from what's going on and have an intimacy with that fear, and that is the way to peace. That's the road to peace. See, we need our peace because otherwise we overreact in our life. And I'm like that. I'm an overreactor. Somebody says something, and I don't go into peace, and I just bleh. So we need to begin to recognize that peace so we're not overreacting. Because here's what happened. Fear zaps our power. Fear zaps us from power when we need it the most. Ernest Holmes says this, power, peace is the power at the heart of God. Peace is the power at the heart of God. See, when we're calm, we're much more effective than we're ready to put up our dukes and escalate things all over the place. When we have peace in our heart, and I'm talking about true power here. I'm not talking about bully power, because here's the thing with bully power. It's only as good until the next bully comes along. And then it's over for you.
Yes.
I'm talking about an authentic power, a deep authentic power. The kind of power that we're asking ourselves to learn more about during this season for nonviolence. This season that is 64 days between the anniversary of the death of Mahatma Gandhi and the anniversary of the death of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So why do we use the death of these two men to celebrate? Well, partially it's because of the amount of days, but partially it's also a signal to us that when we don't have peace, people and ideas and hearts begin to die. Peace is important. It's way more important than just, you know, talking about it. It's bringing ourselves completely alive in our life. Well, we have to help ourselves two books to help us. And these are simple, tiny things that will enable you to flex your peace muscles, to work on your peace muscles that are simple. They don't take any time at all. You can do them in seconds every single day. But if you're willing to do them in seconds every single day, you will find at the end of 64 days, you will have learned much more about peace in your life. We have one for adults and one for children. They're perfectly free and they're out there. We encourage you to get one and pick it up and use it every single day to just sort of make a more peaceful presentation to the world, to that God-given power. And God-given peace is what will bring us, you know, lasting change, global lasting change, financial lasting change, even personality lasting change.
Yes.
If we can begin to embrace this notion of peace. But you know what? We have to be really committed to do this. And by really committed, I mean no excuses to really look first for peace in your life. If I were to ask every one of you here today, if you want peace, all of you would say, of course I want peace. Yes, I want peace. But I'm not sure that's true. I've come to understand something, and that is that we want something more than we want peace in our life. Even me, I want something more than I want peace in my life. What I want more than peace in my life is my own way. That's what I want more than peace in my life. And until we can make peace a true priority, until we can not say I want my own way, I want peace more than I want my own way, we won't have peace. We won't have peace. See, right now in this country, the country itself is begging for peace. It's begging for peace and justice on this planet. And when we want our own way, and if you're like me, I not only want my own way, but I want it now. We stop listening. See, I want my own way in terms of civil rights. I want my own way in terms of immigration. I want my own way in terms of freedom of the press. I want my own way in so many different areas that are up for discussion right now. The problem is, because I want my own way, I've stopped listening to what other people want. And there can be no peace when we stop listening. Now, I'm not going to stand up here and say, I've had an epiphany, I read the 64 days, or it's so great, I just want peace and I don't want my own way. Of course I want my own way. This is work.
Yes.
This calls us to work.
Yes.
At this idea of wanting peace and being committed to peace in our life. See, I'm making a commitment now. I'm making a commitment, and I'm telling you, I am part of the resistance movement, and I'm saying that unabashedly. I am part of the resistance movement. But as part of this resistance movement, I am not going to make anybody bad. I'm not going to start hating on anybody. I'm going to stop talking about comb-overs. I'm going to stop talking about orange people. I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm leaving that to Trevor Noah and the other Nate-like people. I'll watch it in the privacy of my own home. But I'm not going to contribute to it anymore. I'm not. I'm going to stop being a hater on this planet. Now, that doesn't mean that I'm going to give up my resistance. But I'm only going to resist proposals. I'm only going to resist kind of mean-spirited talk. I'm not going to resist people anymore. I'm not going to make any more enemies out of what's going on. Well, so I want to talk about, you know, we're a practical church and we're late today, so I'm going to run through five or six really quickly of things that you and I can do to sort of be in conscious contact with a peace in our life. And the first one is get rid of the old definition of peace. Let it go.
Yes.
We are not talking about being a doormat here.
Okay.
The legacy of Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King, Rosa Parks, and so many others, they weren't doormats. They didn't let people run around and kick them. See, those people respected themselves. And whenever we respect ourselves, no matter what everybody else is doing out there, the respect will start to come our way if we truly begin to respect ourselves. See, some of us have been doormats so long, we're running around with a little sign that says, kick me, right on our forehead. and it can only be read by the people who want to just do that very thing. But let me tell you, there are tons of them out there who don't feel good enough about themselves and who will accommodate you in a heartbeat. So our work is to begin to develop ways in which we can listen to the modeling of Dr. King. Listen to the modeling of Mahatma Gandhi. You know, if you spend enough time in a tribe that's been kicked, in a marriage that's been kicked, in a job in which you've been kicked, you spend enough time in that, and pretty soon it looks to you like it's just business as usual. It's just what happens. And we even use that phrase, that's just what happens in my family. No, it doesn't. It happens because we give it permission to happen in our family. Second thing is trust your peace you have in your heart. You have peace in your heart. You know. Begin to trust it. Some of the messes that you've gotten yourself into, many of the messes that I've gotten myself into, it's because I didn't trust following my own peace. When we trust ourselves to follow our own peace, we'll know. We shouldn't go to that party. That party's not for us. I don't belong there. That's what my peace is saying. Sometimes it's a business deal. Trust yourself. You have an opportunity to do business with somebody, but somewhere in your heart, you're not at peace with it. Trust your own peace. In so many of the different, you know, I've said this before, I've seen people get married and they're walking right down the aisle. There's no peace in their heart about it. But they continue to do it. Trust your own peace. Follow it. The third one is find your own button and cover it up. Find your own button and cover it up. You've heard the phrase, sticks and stones will break my bones, but names will never hurt me. No. No, that's not true at all. By the time we get to be this age and we get to be in this kind of an environment, nobody's throwing sticks at us and nobody's throwing stones at us, but people are still throwing names at us. And sometimes it hurts. And here's what I'm here to tell you. If somebody throws a name at you, somebody calls you something, and it hurts you, you tithe to them. You thank them. You send them a card and thank them because they have just done you a great gift. They have allowed you to know where your work is, where your internal work needs to be. We need to ask ourselves, what was just said that hurt my feelings and why?
Yeah.
Because most of the stuff that hurts our feelings are attached to buttons that were put in there when we were very little people,
yeah,
by parents or grandparents or clergy or teachers. And look, if you're serious about this, if you're serious about unhooking your buttons, you show up at Vina's workshop today, right after service. And look at what your ancestors, look at all of that. Take a look at it. But by and large, don't waste any more time. Go to the workshop and then don't waste any more time on how it got there. Spend all of your time on figuring out why it hurts you. Because if somebody said something bad to you because you didn't go to college, somebody said you weren't pretty, handsome, compassionate, sensitive, whatever it was that hurt you, know that that's an alternative fact. The real truth is that you are whole, perfect, and complete right now. And nothing anybody should be saying to you. And if they're saying something and it gets a reaction, you got work to do.
That's right.
Can't figure out how to do it? Practitioners, please stand again. These people will help you. These people will help you figure out what it is. Thank you. You may be seated. The last one, the fourth one, commit to having no enemies. And this is so serious for us right now. When I got this simple, because my whole pre-church life was in politics, and I had to have enemies in order to do the very radical work that I had been doing. I had to have them. And then I came to this church and I read Dr. Holmes and I began to get into classes and I realized there is no enemy because we are all one. There is no other because we are all one in our life. And so when I began to understand that, I still have people who irk me. I do. But I follow the teachings of Dr. King, who we celebrate during this Black History Month. And you've all heard the story about him marching and somebody spit upon him. And he took his handkerchief out and he wiped off the spit. And he went to the person who spit on him and he handed back the handkerchief. And he said, "Sir, I think this belongs to you. I think this belongs to you." And that's how we want to behave in our life. No enemies. Fifth one, learn to let go with love. You know, sometimes, even though we don't have enemies, it behooves us to step back. The Bible says, "My Father's house has many mansions."
Oh.
It means that there are many states of consciousness.
That's right.
If you have a state of consciousness that is in somebody who is harming you or hurting you, just step back. It doesn't mean you leave in anger. But it's not only people, it's also situations in your life. If you have a stack of bills and they are robbing you of your harmony, we're not saying don't pay your bills, we're saying get back to them. But step back, if you're in that fear, step back and call peace in your life. If you have a situation where you're always fighting with somebody, in the midst of the dishes flying, say, step back and call peace in your life. Now this seems like a really simple thing and too simple to do, but try it. Just try it. The next time in your office, when some things are going wrong in your office, try just stepping back and saying peace. The next time you get a scary diagnosis, try to step back. Stay off the internet. Step back and say peace in your life. Most of you know, whether you grew up Christian or Jewish or Muslim or Hindu or wherever you grew up, you know the story from the Bible in which the apostles were all out fishing and a storm came up and Jesus was taking a nap. And the apostles were freaking out. "We're gonna die, we're gonna die, we're gonna die, we're gonna die. Jesus, get up. Do something." And he did. He got up and he did something. And what he did was to call peace. Peace. You and I can do that. I lied when I said I was gonna do five things. It's six. And the sixth thing is to pray. Each of you have in your bulletin a country. A little card with a country. Will you take it out now? I'm going to ask you to adopt your country for 64 days. If you don't have one, please raise your hand. Our ushers have extras. Okay, ushers. Great. We have one up here, Scarlett, up here. A bunch over there. Do we have enough? Yeah. Back over there. Back in the back, we have some people. Back over here. Aren't you glad you wore your sneakers today, Scarlett? Yeah. All right. So this is the country we're going to ask you to adopt for the next 64 days. And we're going to ask you to pray for this country. We're also going to ask you to learn something about the country. We're going to ask you to go on the internet and learn, what do they eat? What language do they speak? Can I learn two or three words of this country's language? What do the dads do when they go to work? What do the moms do when they go to work? How do the children play? What games do they play? We're going to ask you to learn more about this country. And we're going to ask you every single day to pray for it. So maybe you want to take this card and tape it to your Wheaties box so you see it every day or whatever. But we're going to ask you to pray in a specific way. You have heard me say there is no right way to pray. And I mean that. If you pray the rosary, that's a great way. If you pray bow to the east, that's a great way to pray. If you pray just singing and talking to God, that's a great way to pray. But I'm going to ask you to pray our way to pray, which is the affirmative way to pray. I want you to take your country and say, this is my country. And what I want you to do with that is then begin to see success in every area of that country's life. There's no domestic violence in my country. There's prosperity in my country. There's freedom in my country. In my country, girls and boys get to get educated. Whatever it is. Now, some of you have countries that might look like they have no problem. Maybe you got France, maybe you got United States. Then you really have a job, okay? Maybe you got a country and you can't see what we would possibly pray for. I'm telling you, every country needs our prayers. So pray for those. So we're gonna release it, cut them in half, rip them in half. Rick, if you'll come and stand right here, I'm going to stand over here. The rows are going to be released. And we're going to ask you to, can you go get Sam, please? And we're going to ask you to just come up, and the ecclesiastical staff will pray for you, half of your country. You'll have half, we'll have half. So if you'll just release the rows now. Let's take this message into prayer, knowing that the power, the presence, and the peace of God is right where we are right now, showering peace in this country. So simply we turn our attention to it, we open up to it, we share it with others, knowing that it cannot come back to us void. I give thanks for this. I release this word into the lives.